It's that time of year when the October sittings of the TMUA and ESAT are looming on the horizon. Hopefully students taking the exams in October have now started exploring some past paper practice. Given the intense time pressure of these exams and their multiple choice nature, exam technique can be a very subtle matter. And yet it can easily become the deciding factor in determining whether you secure a good score. While this video won't be a definitive guide to exam technique for the TMUA and the ESAT, we're going to go through a range of tips that can help you improve your score. Firstly, bear in mind that writing less can sometimes be a false economy. Given the very intense time pressure, you have around 90 seconds on average per ESAT problem, about 3 minutes 45 seconds per TMUA problem, it can be very tempting to write very little, to make large leaps in your head, and not to organise or present at all your reasoning on the page. Given that it's a multiple choice exam, students will often think, well, no one's going to look at my working, so why should I bother setting it out in a sensible or remotely detailed way? However, you are going to be looking at your own workings. Sometimes, if you don't present your work in any detail at all, if you find you've made a small mistake somewhere, it can be very difficult to retrace your steps and actually find where the error has crept in. So you might save a few seconds by not writing a particular line of working or a brief comment explaining what you're doing, but then lose 30 seconds or a minute because you're having to redo the calculation and piece together chaotic workings. So while I'm not suggesting that you necessarily should be writing as much as you would in an exam which isn't multiple choice, it can be useful to try to set your workings out sensibly, include more explicitly on the page, and even make a few written brief comments in shorthand outlining what you're doing. Aside from the fact that this can help you to avoid making mistakes in the first place and can make debugging quicker, it also means it will be much easier when you're finished with a problem to simply re-scan through your workings and spot any mistakes that you may have made to do a final sanity check. So of course it's going to take some variation in your strategy to determine the right amount to be writing for you, but a really instructive experiment can be to try one mock where you imagine there are method marks. Of course, you may not want to write this much in the real thing, but pretend there are method marks. Write the amount that you would in that case and see what happens. Students are often surprised at just how much there is time to write and just how much time this actually saves in the long run. Secondly, it's very useful to have a clear strategy for when you're going to move on from a problem. These are very time-pressured exams, and even students who secure very high scores won't get everything right. It's not the end of the world if you move on from one problem, either because you find you're not getting anywhere, you're confused and not sure what to do, or you decide it's simply taking too much time. But if you fall into the trap of letting one question eat up too much time, it can have catastrophic consequences for your overall marks. It's much easier than you might think to inadvertently spend 5-6 minutes on one ESAT problem, say, falling into the trap of thinking, well, I've spent this long on it already, I can't stop now. And even if you end up getting the answer correct in the end, that one question will then have used up the time that should have been spent for maybe 3-4 other problems. So this can have a really severe impact on your score if it stops you from getting to the end. Now, on the past papers, say for NSAA, for TMUA, the questions were generally organised, not linearly by difficulty, but such that the easiest questions were at the start and the hardest questions were at the end. So if you ran out of time, not the end of the world, you're likely only missing the harder problems anyway. The indications from ESAT and TMUA in 2024 was that the question order was randomised because students were served a random sample from a larger question bank. So it may now be that there are some nice low-hanging fruits at the end. This means it's more important than ever not to run out of time and therefore to make sure that you are at least having a go at every problem. Although it can require some experimentation to find what works best for you, a good default strategy is to have a time limit of, say, around 2 minutes for ESAT and around 4 minutes for TMUA, such that if you get to that amount of time and you're not actively in the process of finishing up, you know, you're just solving a quadratic equation, you're essentially done. If you're not actively in the process of finishing up, force yourself to move on. Don't fall into the sunk cost fallacy of just continuing and sinking more time into these problems. And then with experimentation, you might modify the time limit and so on. You might slightly tweak the strategy. But having some principle that triggers moving on is really important for minimizing the damage of wasting too much time on one problem. Thirdly, don't forget that since this is a multiple choice exam, elimination can be a useful tool. Now, it's quite rare that you will actually be intended or even able to pin down a unique answer by eliminating all of the alternatives. Although some problems, like, say, identify the correct sketch of this graph, might be solvable that way. More often, it will be the case that certain options can be eliminated on the grounds that they have some obvious flaw. And then to actually pin down a unique answer, you would still need to, you know, solve the question directly. But especially if you're going to be, for example, moving on and therefore putting a guess, remember there's no negative marking in these exams. If you've managed to eliminate half of the options, you've doubled the odds that you'll guess correctly. So elimination can be really helpful. So there are certain things that can help with this. Suppose, for example, it's a physics calculation where you're trying to work out an expression for, say, a resistance in terms of some physical parameters given in the problem. You can check the dimensions. For example, an expression which is a resistance divided by a resistance squared cannot possibly be correct because it's going to have units 1/ohms rather than ohms. So dimensional analysis, for example, for physics can often let you rule out lots of options very quickly. Or in mathematics, maybe you have a biased coin with parameter p for the probability that it throws heads. You work out a formula for the probability of some event, maybe the probability that you get, you know, a certain sequence of heads and tails in terms of p. If you can realize that some of the given expressions won't always be between 0 and 1 for sensible choices of the parameter p, then it must be an incorrect answer. So there are lots of little things that you can do that might not let you get straight to the right answer, but might let you rule out some options. This can be really helpful, especially if you're moving on and having to make a guess. And remember that such checks can also be useful as a kind of final sanity check on your answer. So you should definitely get into the habit, say in physics, if you're deriving an answer which is in terms of dimensionful parameters, always do a quick mental check of what the units are. Because many of the mistakes that you might make would mess up the units. And so this can actually let you catch many of the errors that you might have made. Another important thing to bear in mind is that although the exams are multiple choice, we shouldn't let this lull us into a false sense of security. So if we've performed some sort of calculation, maybe we've worked out a force due to a magnetic field in ESAT physics, or we've worked out the product of the roots of some equation in TMUA, you know, any of the sorts of things we might be working out, it's very tempting to think, well, okay, the answer I've gotten is one of the options. That can't have happened by chance, therefore it must be correct. I don't even need to go back and, you know, quickly double check before moving on. There's no way that I would have by chance gotten a wrong answer that's listed as one of the options. But the examiners are very devious. When they're populating the question with the multiple choice answers, they won't just make up random wrong answers. If there are particular algebraic slips or particular conceptual tricks, even traps they have deliberately set, they will make sure that among the multiple choices, the outcomes of these common mistakes are listed. So you shouldn't take it as an enormous source of reassurance in itself, just that you're finding an answer which is one of the given options. You should always scrutinize your work at the end, go back, do a quick check, read through what you've done before moving on. Finally, remember that although there are some clear guidelines for general good practice, there is no one size fits all when it comes to exam technique on the ESAT and the TMUA. You need to be experimenting. As much as possible, every past paper that you're working through, so usually NSAA, for example, for ESAT, the real TMUA papers for TMUA, you should always, as much as possible, be beginning with a timed mock so that you can familiarize yourself with the sense of time pressure and so that you can experiment with small modifications to your exam technique. Things like slightly changing what the threshold is to trigger moving on. Things like varying how much you're writing when you're working through a particular problem. You often won't know what works best for you until you've experimented and fine-tuned. So as well as working through lots of papers in formal mock conditions and tracking your scores to keep an eye on general progress, it's very helpful to track other key data points that might help you to inform any modifications to your exam technique. For example, keep track of how many questions you're getting wrong due to silly mistakes. And also keep track of how many questions you're actually not having time to look at because you're running out of time. Very often, exam technique boils down to getting the balance right between speed and accuracy. And if you're able to keep track of essentially the main avatars of these two consequences, silly mistakes and unattempted questions, it's much easier to think about which way you want to tilt the balance. So track this sort of data, as well as obviously other things like any particular topic that are causing issues, so that that can motivate further revision. Every new mock is an experience to try something new with your exam technique and to further fine-tune what you're doing. Getting on top of exam technique is going to be one of the most important factors in determining your score. It can be as important as your mastery of the subject areas. But with lots of practice and careful reflection, you can use this to your advantage. If you've found any particular strategies helpful, why not share in the comments below? And if you'd like more support with ESAT, TMUA, and related exams, do check out our website where you can read details of the preparation programs we offer. I hope you found this video helpful. Do remember to like and subscribe if you'd like more content relating to the university admissions exams. And thank you very much for watching.